Would you join me and let's pray together and let's prepare to hear God's word. Father, we come before you. And Lord, we're just grateful for your church. We're grateful for the opportunity that we have to be here. Lord, we lift you up. We magnify you. We exalt you in this house. And Lord, we just ask that Jesus be lifted high above every other name in this place. Lord, it's not about a man. It's not about a woman. It's not about the old or the young or tradition. Lord, we exalt that we acknowledge that this is the place that we come to hear Jesus as our senior leader. So Father, in the name of Jesus, we ask your Holy Spirit would speak to us tonight, would teach us and guide us and direct us and motivate us and remind us of your word as we may have already heard before. But Lord, I pray that we would take it tonight and we would apply it and we would plant that seed of the word of God into our hearts and into our lives. And as we plant that seed and we water your word, Father, I pray that it would bear much fruit for us, Lord. Much fruit that people would see, Lord, and they would look at us and they would glorify you and see your work and your change in our lives. And so, Father, we thank you for that, Lord. We thank you for the blessings that come with your word, the blessings that come with your worship. And Lord, we don't ask these blessings upon ourselves, but upon all of our brothers and sisters that are teaching and hearing the gospel of Jesus Christ tonight, in this week, throughout the course, throughout the Inland Empire and around the world. Lord, we ask that you would bless them as you bless us, Lord. It's so neat to hear the fruit of Harvest America, Lord, and the crusade that took place this last weekend in Texas. Lord, thank you to hear thousands and thousands of souls coming to know Jesus Christ. So, Father, we thank you that you bless churches like Harvest, bless churches like The Grove, bless churches and movements like Calvary Chapel and Water of Life. Lord, we thank you that you would bless them as you bless us. Speak to them and move through them, Holy Spirit, as we ask that you would speak to us and move through us. In Jesus' mighty name, we'll give you the praise and the glory and the honor. And we all said together, amen. 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 Well, tonight I wanted to talk to you about something that kind of I've been going through in my own life, kind of in and out of. And I'll tell you, there's nothing like preaching a message to yourself. So I just tell you right now that as I was writing this, as I was preparing it, you know what? If you don't get anything out of it and you're like, Pastor Luke, that was incoherent rambling for the next 25, that's faith speaking right there, 30 minutes, at least I got something out of it. No, I'm just kidding. I know you'll get something out of it because it's the Word of God. But today I want to talk to you about sowing seed and changing seasons. Sowing seed in changing seasons. I think that's the title or the very, there we go. Sowing seed in changing seasons. Tonight I want to talk to you about that. You know, in my own life, I'm kind of in that in-between. In that in-between season of life, you know, I can think back to January of 2015, the very beginning of last year. Man, it was awesome. I mean, life was just going. I was growing. I was like content. It was just like, I was on this like unstoppable force that God was just pushing me. Like there was these things that I had put into motion in my own life of change, and that change began to notice, and people were telling me things were good. Stacy had just started her real estate career, officially launched it in 2015, and I mean, it was just blossoming and growing. The first part of 2015 was like amazing. I mean, we were just having the time of our lives. Just, oh, it was so good. Yeah, amen. And then, you know what? And then like a switch, something happened. And it changed. It changed. The way we felt on the inside changed. Stacy's real estate ventures changed. The way we're viewing things changed. Emotionally, it changed. With our kids, it changed. At work, it changed. With spirituality and my Christianity and my relationship with God, there was just something that just kind of like changed. And all of a sudden, it was this different season of life. And it's like, all of a sudden, I'm asking God, God, what did I do? Did I do something wrong? Did I mess up? What's happening to me? What's going on? Well, I don't understand. Everything was going so good. And now it's kind of like all of the momentum, all of the progress, everything that was going on is kind of like screeching to a halt. Like all the cogs that were meshing together in my life were perfectly like somebody put a wrench in the machine and everything's kind of grinding and it's weird. You know, I think it's safe to say that in the course of your life, at some point, you've probably experienced different seasons as well. Different seasons, things where everything was going well, things were going, you know, super good for you, everything was on an upswing, you know, you're kind of going through, and it's like that exponential curve. It's like everything you do just builds upon the next, and it's just going wonderful. The business, all of a sudden, all that hard work that you've been putting in, you know, the business, it starts taking off, or maybe it's, you know, you started giving in the church and started sowing into the kingdom of God, tithing, and, you know, at first it was difficult, and the devil was attacking your finances, but you saw after that, like it was this uptick of you know, God's provision and his blessing, or you know what, you started dedicating some more time in your devotional life to prayer and to reading the Bible, and it's like that first week or that first month or that first season of dedicating or getting into God's word, it's like he was just like showering you with revelation and knowledge, and you're like, this is amazing, I can't wait for tomorrow. And then all of a sudden something happens, And the season changes. The business that was doing well stops doing well. The finances that were coming in, they kind of start drying up. The relationships, like, you know, maybe you were in a tough relationship and maybe you guys were trying to patch it up and it seems like you were going through that season and it's like, hey, we're going to make it through this. And then all of a sudden it's like, what happened to everything we were doing? It's like we're going back downhill and all of a sudden everything starts to change. Maybe it's in school, a semester, you know, you had one semester that it was amazing, and then you got that one teacher, because it's not your fault, it's the teacher's fault. Or, you know, like at the job, it's the manager's fault. They hired that new guy, and if they would have just listened to you. And seasons, they change. Life brings its ups and its downs and its ins and its outs. And you know what? The first thing I think human reaction is, like me, what I was doing in my life, and even still to some extent, asking God, it's like, what did I do? Right? We start looking back and you know, start saying, like, God, is there sin? Did I mess up? I'm not aware of it. Please make me aware of it because I want this to stop. I want to keep growing. I want to keep getting blessed. I want to keep advancing in life. And so we start to look and we start to reflect on the season. We say, what did we do that made it decline? What did we do that made it change? What happened? All of a sudden, it's like a switch got flipped and everything that made sense no longer makes sense. And everything that was right is no longer right. And everything that was growing and producing is tapering off and it's no longer producing anymore. And I got to get back to that because I've got bills to pay. I've got relationships to mend. I've got pressures in life. And I want to be there and not here. Can anybody relate? Well, praise God, I'm not preaching to myself. I'm preaching to four of you. Amen. You see, we all go through seasons in life. They change. But you know, the thing is that there's comfort in knowing that the Bible addresses this specifically and directly to you and I. As a matter of fact, I'm going to take you there today. We're going to look at what the Bible talks about in wisdom and in understanding. In the book of Ecclesiastes, the preacher whom we believe and most scholars believe to be Solomon, King Solomon, who writes. So turn into Ecclesiastes, the third chapter. Say, Pastor Luke, where is Ecclesiastes? It's so easy to find. It's right where I put the ribbon in my Bible. You know what? It's also like right pretty much like in the middle. So like find the middle and go left or right and you'll find it. If you can't find it, go to the first page of your Bible, call the concordance. That's what that's for. And it'll tell you what page number it's on. Mine's on page 458. Okay. Ecclesiastes, the third chapter. The Bible has a lot to say about seasons in life. And I think if anything, we can find some comfort and we can find some solace and we can find some wisdom and we can find some understanding because every season's going to be different. And every person in every walk of life is going to have different seasons than the person next. I don't know if there's anything more frustrating to me than when I'm in a season of hard, a wilderness experience, so to say. Maybe if you look at the four seasons of life, I'm in winter. There's nothing like more frustrating than to be close to somebody who's like in summer, right? And they're like, everything's going well, and you're just like, I hate you right now. I really do, because misery loves company. We know that, right? But we can have an understanding of what the Word of God says about our lives, about your life, about my life, about the changes that will come, because life is, if there's anything we know about life, the only consistent thing we know about life is that it's going to be full of inconsistencies, right? Unexpected events, things that we could not anticipate or things that we did not see, but yet they come our way, and they bring about change in our lives, and thank God, the Word of God addresses this. And so here in Ecclesiastes in the third chapter, I'm going to read verse number 1 all the way through verse number 8. And so here it says in verse number 1, it says, to everything there's a season. To everything there's a season. It's so important to understand. He's not talking about, listen, you know what, in your finances there's a season. He's not talking about in your romance there's a season. Hey, you know what? In your business, there's a season. You know what? In your happiness, there's a season. He says to everything. What does everything mean? Everything. It means everything. It means all. Everything in life, every area, every aspect of our lives, there's a season, which means that the things that we don't want seasons and the things that we do want seasons, hallelujah, there are seasons. He says to everything, there is a season. A time for every purpose under heaven. What does every purpose under heaven mean? Everything. Everything we encounter in life is dedicated and locked into a cycle or a process of seasons that we go through in life, which means maybe right now you're in a good season. I don't want to be the bearer of bad news or to speak ill over that season, but that season is likely to change at some point in your life. Maybe you're like me, where you're like, you know what, I'm kind of chilling in winter right now, and I forgot my coat. And I really am excited for spring. Amen. Thank God that we can understand that to everything there's a season. And if you're in the dead of winter in a snowstorm in your life without a coat or a heater, guess what? There's a season coming your way. To everything, there's a season. A time for every purpose under heaven. Look at this. A time to be born. Amen. A time to die. A time to plant and a time to pluck what is planted or to harvest. Verse number 3, a time to kill and a time to heal, a time to break down and a time to build up. Think about that, a time to fight and a time to sit back and rest, a time to break down things and tear down walls and a time to build them back up, a time to weep or cry or get, you know, somber and solemn, and a time to laugh, a time to mourn and a time to dance. A time to cast away stones and a time to gather stones. A time to embrace and a time to refrain from embracing. You need time with people and you need time away from people. Amen. A time to gain, a time to lose. A time to keep, a time to throw away. A time to tear, a time to sow. A time to keep silence and a time to speak. A time to love and a time to hate. A time of war and a time of peace. So here we believe it's Solomon as he writes this wisdom. He says in everything in life there's a time and there's a season. In every area of your life, your relationships, your family, the friendships that you have or the closeness that you have with somebody now, it's not going to be that way. Whether it'll be better or whether it'll be worse, it's a season. Your finances, your possessions, your emotions, you know, the people that you live with, the people that you share life with, they're going to come and they're going to go. There's going to be seasons of ups and there's going to be seasons of downs. There's going to be seasons of ins and there's going to be seasons of outs. And what Solomon does in his great wisdom, I believe here, is he paints the most vivid picture of the juxtaposition of humanity that we can see. The juxtaposition is the comparison between two things that reveal how opposite they are. Like the laws of gravity, you saw that, remember that? What goes up, right, must come down. He says for every season, you're going to have an up. And for every up season, there's a down. For every season that there's an in, there's a season that there's an out. And you see, that's hard for us to get a hold of. That's an uncomfortable concept for us. Can we just talk for real? Because you see, we're all byproducts of the Industrial Revolution in the 18th or the 20th century, the 19th and 20th century. And the Industrial Revolution showed that a company, a corporation, a country can produce and have the process of continual improvement. And so there's always this gaining and growing. And we see the stock market. You want to have a stock that just goes up, 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 up. But have you ever looked at the stock market? Even if it goes up, it's a jaggedy ride up, right? It goes up, then it goes down, then it goes up a little bit, then it goes down, then it goes up, 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 then it goes down. Way down in 2009, 2010, 2011, then it starts crawling back up. It goes up. Everything, there's a season, and there's a juxtaposition. It's like the teeter-totter of life. On one hand, you've got the good. On the other hand, you've got the bad. On one hand, you've got the in. On the other hand, you've got the out. And depending on where you're at in life, depending on where you're at in that certain circumstance, in that certain situation, in that certain relationship, it's like this swinging teeter-totter that says, you know what, right now I'm in the season of this, or I'm in the season of this. I'm in the season of embracing, or I'm in the season of not embracing. I feel really alone right now. I'm in the season of weeping, I just can't help, but I just feel like crying all the time. Or I'm in the season, man, things are going so good, I can't stop laughing. I mean, I'm just laughing all the way to the bank, literally. There's a time it says to grow and a time to recede. He uses the example like this. The very first example he uses is the time to plant and a time to harvest or to pull or to pull out that which was planted. And there's this amazing juxtaposition that we see. And the reality of the message that he's producing, that he's writing with the word of God, is for you and I to understand is that not every season produces growth. Not every season produces growth. Okay, now we could argue that with science. We could argue that, you know, looking around. And Pastor Luke, if it's winter here, it's summer in South America. And you know what? We can't grow lettuce in Arizona in the summer, but we can grow lettuce in Arizona in the winter. But if you look at nature at its basics, without humanity trying to figure out and how to bend the rules of nature, there are seasons of growth and there are seasons of decline, right? Pastor Becker was talking about being in South Africa, and Easter happens to be upon fall. It's really hard to talk about the resurrection of Jesus Christ when everything around you is dying, right? Fall, everything starts to die, the leaves start to wither, and then all of a sudden winter comes, and everything goes dormant. I even remember when we were in Oklahoma, in Tulsa, Oklahoma, the wintertime was freezing, 10 below zero on some days, and they had this koi pond that would freeze over at the Bible college, and I was always amazed at how the koi were still in the pond in the wintertime. And I asked somebody about that, and they said, oh, they just go into hibernation. They literally stop moving for 4 or 5 months, and then they wake up and everything's good again. Bears, they do that, right? They store up, they grow, and then in wintertime they go into hibernation and their body eats itself, the reserves that they've stored up, and then they come out hungry again. We see this at work in nature. We see this at work in the laws that God had set forth, that there's a time of growth and there's a time of decline. But because of our culture, perhaps because of our interpretation of the Word of God and focusing merely and solely upon the blessings of God and not on the times of decline or on the times of learning or the times of wilderness, we get frustrated with that concept. But no, I want to be in a period of growth all of my life. I only want to see progress. I only want to see forward momentum. And when I'm not in that season of growth, I get mad. Anybody can say amen to that one? Man, I'm just downright fed up of it. But you see, we need to understand that the laws of nature apply here because there's a season of growth and there's a season of decline. And when we have the mature and realistic understanding that the seasons that we go through in life, not every one of those seasons is going to produce growth in us, then we can look and take a realistic expectation to say, you know what? Maybe what's happening to you right now is not because you're in sin. Maybe what's happening to you right now is not because you're doing something wrong. Maybe what's happening to you right now, or if it's not happening to you, maybe that which will happen to you, and then you remember this message, maybe what's happening to you is just the natural course of seasons that God has set forth in your life, the seasons of ups and the seasons of downs. And you know what that does? At least for me, you know what that does? That lets me take a big, deep breath. Whew! I'm normal. Amen. If the tree in my backyard can lose its leaf in the wintertime, thank God I can go through hard seasons and lose a couple of leaves. Thank God there's a little bit of hardship going on, but you know what? I have seen through the years, I have seen through the course of my life, I have seen through the laws of nature that are irrevocable and unchangeable, that each season precedes another one. And if I'm in winter, I know that there will be spring and there will be a summer. And you know what? If I'm in summer, hey, you know what? I'm going to ride summer out and have as good of a time in summer as I can. Because summer is followed by fall and then by winter. And we have an understanding that, you know what? God wants to do something in us, but not every season in us produces growth. But we need to understand that just because it produces growth doesn't mean that we need to get off that we're let off the hook in that season. Because what happens is we take that big sigh of relief like me and we say, oh my goodness, thank the Lord, I'm normal. Take a big deep breath. Everybody just take a big deep breath. You're normal. Amen. Feels good, doesn't it? To know that just because you're going through a season that somebody else is going through also, and that somebody else may have already gone through, it doesn't mean that it's a time to sit back and do nothing with it. to ride it out. Well, you know what? I'm going to hibernate through winter. I like the bear example. Pastor Luke, you said it from the pulpit, therefore I'm going to apply it to my life. I'm going to take the bear model and I'm going to gorge in the summer and hibernate through the winter. Because you see, when you look at this, Solomon used the example early on. He talked about the farmer. He says that there's a time to plant and there's a time to harvest. And if you've ever noticed about what farmers do and what they don't do, they do not plant in harvest, right? They harvest in harvest. So therefore, if you don't plant in harvest, you're planting in the downtime and you're waiting until harvest comes, which means that the seasons of non-growth are not seasons of non-work. Let that settle in for a second. The seasons, or a no-growth season, is not a no-work season. Pastor Luke, I'm in a wilderness. Pastor Luke, I'm in the winter. Pastor Luke, I am dying on the inside. I'm waiting for God to bring summer about me. That does not mean because you're in that season of no-growth that you get to sit back and not put anything into it. Because in that low is a time of preparation for the high. And you will get what you put into it. There's a law, just like the law of gravity. You can't escape it on earth. It happens because the earth is spinning. And because the earth is spinning and centrifugal force is in application, it cannot be stopped. You cannot halt gravity, just like you cannot halt displacement. That's why big boats can float no matter how big they make it, because as long as it displaces the amount of water by volume, it will float. It's science. Just like that is a law, the Bible tells us, that you cannot escape. It's called the law of, you know it, what you sow, you will reap. What you put in is what you'll get out. That's a law. It's inescapable. Pastor Luke, I don't like that law. Amen. I don't like it either. I don't like gravity. I want to be on the moon. Anyways, that's a different story. Galatians in the 6th chapter. You can put a ribbon there in Ecclesiastes because we'll come back to verse chapter 11 in a minute. But Galatians in the 6th chapter says it like this. Galatians in the 6th chapter, verse number 7, it says, don't be deceived. God is not mocked. Man, you can't fool God. But Lord, I sowed in the wintertime. And God's like, no, you didn't. You sat around. You hibernated. You literally took the bear model and did nothing during the wintertime. And you came out of wintertime starving and angry. They call that hangry. God cannot be mocked. You can't pull the wool over God's eyes. This is a law set in motion spiritually by God. It says, for whatever a man sows, that will he reap. What you put in is what you're going to get out. He says in verse number 8 that if you sow according to the things of the flesh, you'll reap according to the things of the flesh. You sow to yourself, guess what? You're going to reap to yourself. He says, but if you sow to the things in the Spirit, you'll reap everlasting life. You'll reap the things of the Spirit. And the beautiful thing about seed time and harvest is you plant a seed, but you get a bigger harvest. So you sow spiritual, you sow a small life, an insignificant price here on earth, but you gain a great harvest of heaven and eternal life on the other side. Seed time and harvest. Seasons of ups and downs. So a non-work or a non-growth season does not mean a no-work season. Look what he says in verse number 9. He says this, he says, and let us not grow weary while doing good. For in due season we shall reap if we do not lose heart. But he laid the law before in verse number 7. What did he say about reaping? You have to sow in order to reap. So he's not saying, hey, sit back and relax because it's coming your way. He says, you have taken the time to sow when it was cold. You took the time to sow when it was difficult. You took the time to sow when nothing made sense, but you sow the seed, and now you sit back and you let the seasons do their job, and in due time, if you don't lose heart, amen, you will reap. That's good news. When we moved into our house a couple of years ago, it was right on the upturn of the upswing of the economic downturn. Does that make any sense? I don't know. We bought our house at a good time, okay? So we bought a house, it was repossession, and because it was repossession, there was no backyard, there was no front yard, it was just nasty, and we bought it as a fixer-upper. Well, because we live in an association, there are certain rules that you have to have, and of those rules, you have to maintain a green lawn. Well, I had a green lawn when I bought the house because it was green weeds. But then you know what happens with green weeds in Southern California? Eventually the green weeds turn to really big brown ones. And so we started getting letters from the association. You need to plant a lawn. The weeds in your lawn are unacceptable. We want grass in your front yard and in your backyard. So we said, okay, well, we're going to do what we can. You know, it's the heat of December. It's the middle of the winter. I mean, there's not much going on. So we kind of did the whole thing where you poison all the seeds or the weeds, and they all die. And then you pull it back. And then we planted seeds. And we planted the seed of grass on our front yard. And you know what happened? Right after I planted the seeds in my front yard, I got a letter from my association. You need to change your grass. And I wrote them back, chill out. I just planted seed. It's December. Couple weeks later, this is the second notice we're sending you. You need to plant your lawn. We want a green lawn. So I wrote them back again. Hey, chillax, all right? It's like the 1st of January, and I seeded my lawn. Couple weeks later, this is the third and final notice. We're going to fine you if you don't do your lawn. Finally, I wrote a letter to everybody in the association, like, y'all are harassing me, leave me alone, I just moved in. Have you ever tried to plant something in December? Because I'm trying right now and nothing's happening. And they all finally came, wrote back like, well, we're so sorry, we'll back off. And I didn't get a letter from them for anything for like 2 years. I could leave my trash cans out for as long as I want. It was amazing. But you know what happened? You know what happened to my front lawn? Right around March. Actually, Southern California. Right around the end of January, spring showed up. And all of a sudden, on that dead front lawn, little tiny pieces of grass came through. A couple weeks later, some patches came through. A couple weeks later, it was consistently green. A couple weeks later, Federico could mow it. Amen. And I had a lawn. But you see, it didn't happen overnight, but I had to plant the seed even though it wasn't happening. So a season of no growth does not mean a season of no work. So if you're in a season of no growth, if you're in a season of trying to figure out what's going on, trying to figure out what's happening to me right now, I feel like I'm like the children of Israel wandering in the wilderness and I just want to know what summer's going to bring. Listen, understand something. There are things that the Bible says for you and I that we need to apply and to understand. And that is that there's a time of up and a time of down. And if you're in a time of down, it doesn't mean, hey, kick back and relax. It means do something with it. And with that, what do I do? What do I understand with that principle today? The application for us to understand is, even if it's tough, even if it's hard, even if it hurts, sow good seed. Sow good seed. Now, I didn't say sow seed, because you're going to sow seed no matter what you do. By not doing anything, you're sowing the seed of not doing anything. By being negative, you're sowing the seeds of negativity. By being bitter, by being hurt, by being mad at God for the season, you're sowing seasons of emotional downturns or emotional anguish. The Bible says that if you sow according to the flesh, right? This was a law that the Bible said. If you sow according to the flesh, you will reap according to the flesh. So therefore, even if it hurts, even if it's tough, even if it's hard, sow a good seed. Jesus talks about good and bad seed in Matthew, I think it's the 13th chapter, verse number 24 through 30. I think you can read it through it. It's called the parable of the wheat and the tares. And he says that their farmer went out and he sowed the seed of wheat. And his enemy came and he sowed tares. He sowed bad seeds in his crop, and they grew up together and they couldn't pull them out. They couldn't weed it because one would tear out the other. And he said you had to wait until the very end and then divide them, the good and the bad. So we see and we realize principally, biblically speaking, that there's a principality there that we can sow bad seed or we can sow good seed. In my life, and in the physical example, we have this drainage, and because it was a repo, they didn't plant anything back there. And so there's this hill that whenever it rains, the one time a year it rains, whenever it rains, all the dirt flows into my backyard. So you have to plant something on the hill. And we wanted a quick solution. So my wife and I, we were like, you know what? Let's get that. We were ahead of the game. Remember that, babe? We were like, let's get drought tolerant plants. And we went to Lowe's and we bought California wildflower mix. Do you know what California wildflower mix is? Weeds. Straight out weeds. They grow a flower for about a week, and the rest of the year, they're ugly, they smell bad, they attract all kinds of spiders, it's just nasty. We sowed bad seed, and still to this day, we got things growing. I'm trying to figure out, like, what is that? You see, you can choose to sow good seed, or you can choose to sow bad seed. You can choose to sow that which will produce growth in a no-growth season, or that which will continue the no-growth season even longer than you want. See, you can make a choice, even when it hurts, in your circumstance, to start speaking the seed over it now. You know what? My finances are gonna grow, and I'm going to start giving into the kingdom of God because God says that He'll bless that. And I'll sow a seed even though I'm experiencing financial decline. You know what? Things aren't going so well in my emotions, but I'm going to reach out to somebody else, and I'm going to witness the gospel of Jesus Christ to that person. And I'm going to sow a seed right now that I don't feel like sowing the seed. It hurts. I don't like talking to somebody else, but you know what? I don't feel like I got anything to offer, but I'm going to tell them with the glory and the goodness and the cheerfulness of Jesus Christ on the inside of me. I'm going to tell them that Jesus loves them, and I'm going to sow a seed. You see, you can choose with your children. They're frustrating you. They're annoying you. They're going south. They're going awry. You can say, you know what? They're worthless. You just got all your dad in you. Or you just got all your mom in you. Don't look at each other right now. Or you can say, you know what? This is a season. And you know, you're going to get through this. And you're going to grow up. And you're going to be the great man or the great woman of God that God has called you and destined you to be. It may hurt. It may be painful. But you sow the good seed now. Even when there's no growth. The Bible says, I told you, if you could be there, you could hang out in Ecclesiastes. If you really listen to me, you could turn your thumb back there. If not, I'll put it on the overhead. Ecclesiastes, the 11th chapter, verse number 4, I believe it says this. Ecclesiastes, the 11th chapter, it says, the farmers who wait for perfect weather never plant. Watch every cloud, they never harvest. It says, he who considers the wind will never plant. You know, a couple of years ago, I went fishing with my brother up in the Eastern High Sierras, one of my favorite places to be. We were out there on Lake Crowley. Lake Crowley's just notorious, famous for big honking fish. And every fisherman, every liar just wants to say it was this big. So you go chasing those fish. And so that we were out there, and it's notorious also for winds coming up in the afternoon. And so we were out fishing. It was a terrible day in the morning. So we said, let's go to Lake Crowley so that we can tell everybody lie that we got a fish this big. And we got out there, and the wind was just blowing. The wind was howling. There was white caps on the water. Everybody looked at that. There's about five of us. We had a little float tubes and canoes and kayaks, and there's about five of us, and we said, ain't going to do it. Not fishing today. My brother-in-law drives me bonkers. I've told so many stories about how that guy's got me lost, how that guy's taking me on an adventure. I told my wife I'll be home at noon, and I'm home at noon the next day because we got stuck somewhere. He's that guy. He's like, no, I'm going. And we're like, dude, let's just go back to camp. Let's just go to the store. We didn't get any fish. Let's just go to the store and buy red meat. It tastes better anyways. And we'll just barbecue that. And he's like, no, I'm going fishing. I drove 6 hours to go fishing. I'm going fishing. And so we're all on the shore pouting, throwing a hissy fit, mad at him, throwing rocks, trying to skip it. You know, I'm fiddling with my fishing gear because the wind got it all in a knot, and I literally threw it. It was really bad. It was a really low moment. It was a low season. It was winter. And we're all upset. We're just so mad, and there's no cell phone reception, so there's nothing to do. It's the desolate lake. And all of a sudden, out 300-400 yards out on the ocean, through the howling wind, you just hear, woohoo! A couple minutes later, you hear, woohoo! Yeah! A couple minutes later, woohoo! It's huge! Comes back in with a big old stringer full of brown trout, like this big. Okay, they maybe weren't like that big, but you know, that's just how we do it. But you know, just like Ecclesiastes says, you look at the wind, you look for the perfect weather. I didn't catch any fish that day. I went back to camp mad. But you know what? My brother-in-law, as an example, he didn't count the wind. He didn't count the effort. He didn't count what it was going to take to sow good seed. He says, you know what? I'm going to get out there because I came here to do that. And despite the fact that it's not the ideal conditions in my life right now, I'm going to get out there and I'm going to go. And he was rewarded for his efforts. Even when it's hard, you and I, we can choose to sow good seed in our lives. to sow good seed in our circumstances, to sow good seed, to start speaking those things, to start saying those things, to start planting what the Word of God says, that we might reap a spiritual and everlasting reward, and not a temporal fleshly reward. In the book of Genesis, a man sowed good seeds. In Genesis, the 35th chapter, Jacob and his wife Rachel, his favorite wife, he worked so hard to get Rachel. He was deceived by his father-in-law, and he got tricked, and he married the wrong girl, and then he had to work for her again, and he worked for Rachel. And finally, after 14 years, he's got his bride. And she gives him a son, his name is Joseph. And Joseph is like, you know, Joseph in the coat of many colors, he's the favorite. And then Rachel has another son, and she gives birth, and the Bible says that she had a hard birth. And the Bible tells us in Genesis, the 35th chapter, it says it like this, it says, after a very hard delivery, the midwife finally escaped. She exclaimed, because, you know, back in the day, the men weren't allowed in there, so he's out there pacing, waiting. You know, just like how, you know, like Lucy and Ricky, remember that? Like when baby Ricky was born and he's like, you know, what is it going to be? I don't know. Sonogram didn't show. And the midwife comes out, she's like, celebrate, it's a boy. And he's like, yeah, got heritage, I got lineage. And then she comes back, look what it says in verse number 18. Rachel was about to die. She died giving birth to her son. And it says with her very last breath, she named her son Ben-Oni, which means son of my sorrow. You see, the significance of the name of a person in these days meant everything. It was your association, how everybody looked at you, how they reacted to you, how you lived up to your name. She was setting a curse upon Benjamin that everything life was to be associated with was to be associated with sorrow, was to be associated with pain, was to be associated with the loss of Rachel giving birth to him. So she named him Ben-Oni, which means son of my sorrow. But look what it says. But the baby's father, Jacob, he sowed a seed, however, called him Benjamin, which means son of my right hand. And you see, Benjamin didn't live a life of sorrow. He didn't live a life of recognition of what happened to Rachel upon his death. Benjamin became the pivotal point, the connection, the favored son of Jacob when Joseph was sold into slavery, the catalyst to reunite the family and save the family was all done through Jacob's son, Benjamin, the son of his right hand. In the moment of pain, in the moment of suffering, in the moment of anguish, when Jacob is losing his best friend, his favorite wife, I know back in the day they had more than one, ain't gonna happen no more, amen. He sowed a seed in a time of no growth. The next day his wife was gone, but he made a decision. I'm not gonna name him son of sorrow. I'm gonna sow a seed and I'm gonna name him son of my right hand. Son of my right hand. Whatever you're going through and whatever season you're going through, you have a choice. Even though it might be tough, even though it might be hard, even though it feels like it might even kill you, sow a good seed now so that harvest comes and there's something to be proud of in your life. Monday, Stacy and I and our family, we made a stupid, crazy decision. It was raining. We said, you know what, let's get out of the rain. We don't like the rain. We're Californians. We freak out when it rains. So we said, let's drive to where there's no rain. We had heard about this thing in Death Valley called the Super Bloom. And so we drove 4.5 hours out to Death Valley to witness the Super Bloom. I took a picture of it. It doesn't really do very much justice. But you see, there's all these yellow flowers in Death Valley. And it looks just like that. Yellow flowers in Death Valley. We drove through Death Valley. We drove 4.5 hours to see yellow flowers in the desert. You know what? To be honest with you, the flowers on the side of the freeway look a lot better. They're prettier. There's more variety. There was a bunch of yellow flowers in Death Valley. But then we learned the story of it. The story is that Death Valley only gets two inches of rain a year, but it evaporates 150 of inches of water every year. It's the hottest place on record on Earth and the lowest point in North America. They call it Death Valley because nothing grows in Death Valley. As a matter of fact, the animals that do live in Death Valley, like the lizard and the kangaroo rat, have been created, so to say, I'm gonna throw it like that, created, not adapted, but have been created to extract water within their nose to live without ever having to drink water in Death Valley. And so you see, the amazing thing about the super bloom is that the seeds were already there. But in October of 2015, think about this, October of 2015, it rained abnormally in Death Valley. One rainstorm in October produced water in a place that had no water, and the seed was already planted. And now 5 and 6 months later, people are traveling all over the world to come see what never happens in Death Valley, a super bloom. Billions upon billions upon billions of flowers springing to life in a place that is synonymous with death. The seed was already planted. Although it didn't seem like on a normal year anything would grow, they were there waiting for the rain. And you see, God wants to water your seed. But it's going to take you the effort, the decision, the choice to say, you know what? I am going to plant a good seed in my job. I'm going to plant a good seed in my finances. I'm going to plant a good seed in my kids. I'm going to start saying positive things over my family. I'm going to start saying things to my wife that I don't feel like saying right now, but I'm going to plant a good seed. Or girls, I'm going to say things to my husband that I sure don't feel like saying, but I'm going to plant a good seed. I'm going to plant that. And you know what? That seed, nothing may happen. But one thing we understand and one thing we can see throughout the course of history, throughout the course of nature, is not every seed germinates or grows at the same pace. But God will water your good seed. And when God waters your good seed, you'll start moving out of that low time. You'll start moving out of that death time. You'll start moving out of that winter season, out of that fall season. And all of a sudden, something's going to happen. You're going to move into spring. You're going to move into summer. You're going to start to see the harvest of God in your life. And things are going to change. And I tell you what, life is full of ups and life is full of downs. And we don't have to be downcast and trodden when we're in the winter season, because we can make a decision to sow a seed, a good seed in those seasons, to say, I'm going to make a choice to be like the farmer and to not look at the wind, to not look at the clouds, to not look at the weather, to not look at the conditions, but to push through the dreary atmosphere, to push through the dark nights, and I am going to plant a seed today, expecting that God will bring a harvest tomorrow. The question and the challenge tonight is, are you willing, are you ready, are you able today to plant a seed now for something you may not see come to pass until another day? Are you willing to plant a seed now into somebody's life that you may never see come to pass, but somebody else will? Are you willing right now to start speaking those things over your finances, over your money, over your bank account, over your family, over your relationship, over your emotions, over your fulfillment, over your Christianity, whatever it might be, over your revelation from the Word of God? Are you willing right now to start sowing the seed when it's hard, to reap a harvest when it's easy? Because you see, it's a law. It's a law. It can't be changed. It can't be bent. What you sow, you will reap. You can sow bad seed, or you can sow good seed. You can be like Jacob and have a decision. You know what? I'm going to stick with Rachel's last wish. She wanted him to be called the son of sorrow, but no, I'm going to sow good seed, and I'm going to change that boy's name, and I'm going to speak life over him now so that there is life later on for him. He may not ever see the consequences of that, but you know what? He sowed the good seed. Can you sow good seed in those down seasons? I believe with all my heart, every one of us, we can. We can sow the seed, and we can see the harvest. Did you guys get something out of God's word this evening? Amen. Amen. Did anybody get, just wave at me so I know I didn't preach to myself. All right. Amen. Hey, cool. Like 88%. That's awesome. That's good. I'll take it. Amen. Well, God is so good. Hey, listen, before we leave, I want to just take a quick moment. I'll let you out in just a couple of minutes. Don't get up. Don't leave. Church isn't out yet. All right. Your children, they're in the middle of their thing right now. You're going to interrupt their services. Youth, same thing. Let them do their thing. I promise I'll let you out in just a couple minutes. I want to do something very important with you today right now. And I want to give you the opportunity right now to examine your heart. You know, it's kind of funny right there in Galatians, the 6th chapter talks about that. It says, let a man examine himself. Bible talks about in the communion message, let a man examine himself from time to time. It's a very important principle for you and I to look into ourselves, to be introspective with our life and to say, what is going on with me? And I want you to examine your heart. I want you to examine your life and be open and honest with yourself, because like it said, God is not mocked. He knows the answer. The question is, do you know the answer? And the answer, the question I want to ask you today is this, is if you were to leave tonight and you were to die, heaven forbid that be the case. But listen, the reality is that we see life is fragile. We're all one accident, we're all one incident, we're all one epidemic away from our eternal destiny. And there's a decision, the Bible says that you'll either go one of two places, heaven or hell. There's no other options, there's no other places to go. Well, you know what, I don't believe in that, I just don't know if that's true. Listen, the Bible talks about it, it's real. Just because you want to bury your head in the sand about it, doesn't make it any different, it doesn't make it go away. It's still there when you die. And the decision is, or the question is, will you go to heaven or will you go to hell? It's a very simple question, but you see how you arrive at your answer. What you have to say about that introspection or about that examination has a lot to say about your position and the reality of your place with God. And today I want to take a look at that and examine that and talk to you about that. You see, when I talk to people, I remember I talked to a young man one time and we were talking about this. He says, you know what? I always just thought that I was a good person, or I always thought that I was going to go to heaven. Doesn't that mean I'm going to go to heaven? Sometimes we ask somebody, or you might even say right now in your heart, man, I hope so. Can I hope I get to heaven? But did I tell you, can I tell you that nowhere in the Bible does it say that because you think, because you believe, or because you hope that you're going to get to heaven means you're going to get to heaven? You know, we like to have this magical belief. You know, if you believe, just believe and let it, you know, like Disney likes to push that on us now. And we kind of get there and it's believe in it. You know, that's great. That's wonderful, cool. Believe in a positive life and all those things. But listen, that's not going to get you to heaven. Just because you hope, because you think, because you want to, because you wish. Do you know that nowhere in the Bible does it say that because you attend church on a weekly, on a bi-weekly, on a monthly, or even a yearly basis, on a traditional basis, nowhere in the Bible does it say that because your parents told you growing up that you, as a child, that you were a Christian or that you were a Catholic. Nowhere in the Bible does it say that because you were baptized as a baby or went to catechism or Sunday school classes. Listen, nowhere in the Word of God does it say that because you've given yourself the title of Christian, that means you're going to get to heaven. There's even a story in the Bible where somebody's trying to cast out a demon and they say in the name of Jesus who Paul preaches. And the demon comes back and says, man, I know Jesus. I know Paul. I don't know you. Just because you can use a title, because you can use a name, it doesn't mean that you're going to get into heaven, because it's not about a title. Listen, it's not about a cross around your neck. It's not about an association with a religious organization. There's so much more to it than that, and the Word of God clearly tells us what it is. You know, so often what happens, you think, you know what, I'm a spiritual person. I have a heightened sense of spiritual awareness. I fully believe that there's something or a power, a being, a deity that's larger than I can comprehend. And you know, I feel like I don't understand that, but I know that there's a power at work, and I'm sure that we'll all arrive at whatever that destination is, whatever you want to call it. Listen, can I tell you something? Nowhere in the Bible does it say that because you're spiritually aware. Nowhere does it say that because you're heightened or that you have a spiritual awareness of things, that you believe in a higher force than yourself, that means you're going to get to heaven. Just like it says nowhere does it say that because of classification, because you're not a Buddhist or a Hindu or a Muslim or anything else like that, that you're going to get to heaven. You can't get to heaven because of these kind of systems of classifications. But, Pastor Luke, I understand. Good people, you got to be good. Good people go to heaven. But did you know that nowhere in the Bible does it say that because you're a good person, because you give to charitable organizations, that because you give a little bit of tax money, you roll over the extra dollar at the grocery store, you wear Tom's shoes or whatever it might be, that you're a good person, that good people go to heaven? Did you know that nowhere in the Bible does it say that? As a matter of fact, the Bible tells us that according to God's righteousness, our good deeds are like filthy rags. See, nothing you and I could ever do would ever make us good enough, right enough, clean enough. Earn it, you can't buy it, you can't deserve it, you can't work for it. The only thing you and I can do is accept it. The Bible does say this, it says that the gift of God is eternal salvation through Jesus Christ. It's a gift. And like any gift, you have the decision, the choice, free will to say, you know what, I'm going to take it or I'm going to reject it. Take it or leave it. That's how it goes. So simple, so easy. What is it? How do I do it? Jesus says it this way. Jesus says, speaking to a religious leader at the time in John the 3rd chapter, Jesus says it like this. He says, in order to inherit, in order to see, in order to get the kingdom of God, he says, you must be born again. What does that mean, born again? You know, you think of that culture and society, Hollywood's made a mockery out of that. You think of those weirdo, crazy, out of control Christians, right? Listen, that's not what the Bible's talking about. From the beginning of God's word to the end of God's word, it always means the same thing. It means that you've given all of your heart, you've given all of your life to God the Father through His Son, Jesus Christ. You see, it's an all or nothing relationship. It's not about your mental assent, carnal knowledge of who Jesus is. You can scarcely go anywhere in America and find somebody who doesn't know who Jesus is. Listen, I know all about the President of the United States. I know where he lives. I know his vice president. I know some of the members of his cabinet. But it doesn't mean that I know him personally, that I can call him and phone him up and say, how was your day? I don't know him. I know of him. There's a difference between knowing about Jesus and knowing him personally. The difference is 18 inches of head knowledge or heart knowledge. Today, don't miss God by 18 inches, the distance between your mind and your heart. It's not a carnal knowledge thing. It's not a mental assent thing. It's all of your heart. It's all of your life. Jesus says it like this in the book of Revelation. He says, listen, I'm coming back. He says, if I come back, when I come back, I'd rather find that you're hot. I'd rather find that you're cold. He says, because if I find that you're lukewarm, look at this. He says, I will vomit you from my mouth. And it's like, oh, it's a shocking statement. What did he just say? And what he's saying is that, listen, if you're lukewarm, casual church attendance, casual, religious belief, not doing all of God's thing, not doing all of your thing, kind of floating, riding the fence, a little bit in, a little bit out, occasional church attendance, token prayer. Jesus says, listen, if that's you, you're deceived in thinking you're going to make it. And he says, I will eject you from the kingdom of God. It's a shocking statement, but he doesn't end it with that. He says, listen, I wish that you'd come and I wish that you would buy gold refined for me. He says, I'm going to give you the best stuff. I'm going to give you the best life. I'm going to give you the best clothes. He says, listen, I stand at the door of your life and I knock. And he says it like this. He says, behold, whoever opens the door, I will come in and I will dine with him and they will dine with me. We'll be together. You see, there's an invitation right now to your life. Jesus Christ is knocking on the door of your heart. He's knocking on the door of your life and he's saying, listen, it's time for you to stop doing life your way. It's time for you to stop doing life how you think. It's time for you to stop living frustrated. Stop living empty. Stop trying to fill the emptiness on the inside of you. He says, listen, that was a gaping hole that only I am designed to fill. And he says, I am knocking right now on your heart. And it's time for you to respond. The Bible says that nobody comes to the Father unless the Spirit of God draws him. And I believe right now all across this auditorium, the Spirit of God's drawing you. He's inviting you. There's an invitation right now in your life for change. Change, not just what happens when you die. Jesus said it like this. He says, I have come that you would have life and have it more abundantly. Change tonight in your life for the better. For God. A harvest is coming your way, but it starts by making a decision to follow Jesus Christ. Jesus said it like this. He said, if you confess him before men, he'll confess you before his Father. He goes on, he says, man, if you deny him, he'll deny you before his Father. The decision's yours. He's not a manipulator. God's not a conniver. He's not going to force his way or make his way in. It's your choice today to decide, am I going to follow Jesus or am I not? Today, I want to give you the opportunity. Give you the choice, the decision today to make that choice. And here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to count to three. I'm going to go one, two, and on the count of three, I'll go three. And I'll smack my hands together real loud, just like that. Bang! And when I do, if that's you, I'm going to give you the opportunity to ask you to do something real bold. Right when I clap my hands, I want you to do this. I want you to pop your hand up. You see, what you're doing by the raising of your hand, you're saying, you know what? I want to give God my heart. I want to give God my life. I want to go forward in my relationship with Jesus Christ. Pastor Luke, what you were talking about, man, it's like you were talking right to me. You're making a decision to give your heart, to give your life to Jesus Christ today. You see, I'm a man. I'll see your hand. I'll acknowledge it. You can put it right back down. I think I might be embarrassed. Listen, I'm not here to embarrass you. I'm not here to single you out or call you out or make fun of you or laugh at you. I'm here to build you up in the things and the ways of God. Today is the first day of the rest of your life, the day of your salvation, and it starts by making that decision to follow Jesus in your heart and in your life. Just a moment, if that's you, you pop your hand up, I'll see it, I'll acknowledge it. Who should raise your hands if you've never given him your heart? If you've never given him your life, if that's you, get ready. Pop your hand up, I'll see it. If you're not sure, maybe you did this as a child or in your youth group or at a crusade once before, but you've never really followed through with it, you walk out of this place saying, I don't know, man. Listen, don't walk out of this place tonight without making sure. The Bible tells us that the Holy Spirit is the seal and the stamp of approval of God on us through Jesus Christ, which means you do not need to live your life wondering and hoping that you're going to make it. You can make sure tonight. By solidifying your position with God. Who should raise your hands? If you've been living lukewarm, listen, if you've been running from God instead of to God, listen, like the Bible says, God is not mocked. You can't pull the wool over God's eyes by attending church every once in a while. It's time for you to accept the life of Jesus Christ in your life today and go forward in what God has for you today, throughout the course of your life and eternally with Jesus in heaven. It starts by making that decision today. You've had doctors and dentists. You've had DMV appointments. It's time tonight. You've had a divine appointment. God's got you here right now for this very reason. And tonight I want to invite you to respond to the invitation of the Holy Spirit in your life, calling you home. Come home. Would you do that tonight? All across this auditorium, from the front row to the back row, from side to side, guys in the family rooms, I can see you through the windows. If you're at home watching on the live stream right now, I'm speaking to you. If that's you, get ready. This is your moment. This is your time. The day of your salvation is today. Don't go another moment without making sure today is your moment with God. I'm going to count to three. Wherever you're at, if that's you, get ready. You pop your hand up. You I'll see it. I'll acknowledge it and put it right back down. Pop it up so I can see it. Be proud of it. You're making the greatest decision you could possibly make as a human being. You're doing it right now. Something to be proud of. So as I count to three, if that's you, you get ready. You put your hand up. I'll see it. I'll acknowledge it and put it right back down. And we'll go forward together from there. You ready? Here we go. One, two, three. Let me see your hands in this place today. If that's you today, you say, I want to give my heart, I want to give my life to Jesus. Where are you at? I see that hand right over there. Where are you at in this place today? Let me see your hand. If that's you in this place, come on, be proud. Pop it up. Let me see you in this place today. Two, I see that hand right over there. Three, I see you back over there, sister. Anybody else in this place today? Say, man, I wonder if I should. I got you back there. Anybody else in this place today? Yeah, that's you. Spirit of God speaking to you. Come on. It's time for you to respond. I got you guys back there. Good. I see you. I see you right over here. Good. I see you. Anybody else in this place? You say, man, I wonder if I'd look. I'm not embarrassing them. I'm pointing them out. I'm showing them that I see them. If that's you, come on. I see you right there. Anybody else in this place today? Say, man, I wonder if I should. Come on. It's time for you to accept the invitation of the Holy Spirit in your life, inviting you home. Anybody else today? About six wise people, seven wise people. Anybody else in this place today? Say, man, I wonder if I should. Okay, I see you. Good. Spirit of God speaking to you. He's inviting you. You got butterflies in your stomach. Say, man, I wonder if this guy's ever going to shut up. That's the Spirit of God saying, come on. The uncomfortable draw of God. If that's you, come on. Come home to Jesus. Anybody else in this place today? Anybody else in this place today? Well, praise God for about seven wise people. That's great. That's wonderful. Here's what we're going to do. All seven of you. I think it's about seven, maybe eight. I'll believe in number 9, number 10, number 11, number 12. All right, if that's you. You say, man, I didn't raise my hand, but I should have raised your hand. Spirit of God speaking to you right now. You're saying, oh, I missed it. Dang it. Listen, you didn't miss it. You made a decision to follow Jesus. And listen, let me tell you, this is reasoning. This is logic 101. This is a decision. But no decision is a decision without action. You can make any decision you want, but if you never act on the decision, nothing will ever happen. And today, you're going to act on that decision. So here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to invite every one of you, each and one of you that's raised your hand. If you should have raised your hand, I want you to grab your coat, your sweater, your purse, your Bible, a friend if you need a friend. If you came with a family member, look at them and say, will you go with me? Or if you saw them raise their hand, say, come on, you know what? I'll go with you. Get out of your seat. Get out of your chair. Come meet me right here at this altar. Let's change destinies together, you and I, right here, right now. So if that's you, come on. Get out of your seat. Get out of your chair. Wherever you're at, if that's you, you come. If that's you, you come. Come on. You come. Come on. This is your moment. Praise God. Hey guys, you came. Listen, somebody's got to tell you, okay? Somebody's got to tell you, because maybe nobody ever told you this in your life, but somebody's got to tell you, good job. Good job. Good job. They're all clapping for you. See, you're making the greatest decision you could possibly make right now. You see, you're not going to a funeral. You're going to a birthday celebration. Whose birthday is it? Yours. You're going to get born again. It'll be a whole new creation like the Bible says. Leaving the past behind, going forward for what Jesus Christ has for you. And I tell you what, he's got life and abundant life for you ahead of you. And I tell you, you're just taking the very first step. So somebody's got to tell you, good job. Here's what I want to do. I want to introduce a friend of mine to you. See this guy right over here waving at you? His name's Pastor Joel. Pastor Joel is going to do a couple things. He's going to take you guys just right over there. Nothing weird goes on. I'm the weirdo. You made it through me, okay? I promise I'm as weird as it's going to get. He's going to take you guys right over there. He's going to do a couple things. First, he's going to lead you in a prayer. You're going to invite Jesus Christ to be the Lord and Savior of your life. Lord and Savior? What does that mean? We don't talk like that anymore. You're going to invite him to be the leader of your life. You're going to invite him into your life, okay? You're going to go forward with everything they have in Jesus Christ. Secondly, he's going to give you some free information, some literature. You walk out of this place and say, okay, I just prayed that prayer. What do I do next? We're going to help set you in the right direction. Third thing he's going to do is he's going to invite you to come back. We want you to come back and get connected, okay? We're going to connect you with a friend. We call them spiritual personal trainers. Just like when you go to the gym, you get a personal trainer, somebody that'll teach you how to use that equipment so you don't look like a fool at the gym. We have a spiritual personal trainer, a friend that will meet with you. They'll buy you a cup of coffee, get you some a soda or french fry on a Sunday morning, weekends, or whatever it might be, to sit down with you for just a couple of weeks to teach you some things about the Word of God, to get you strong in the ways of God so that you don't go back to the life that you're walking away from, but you go forward in everything God has for you. So if you guys just turn to your left, my right, go right over there with my buddy, Pastor Joel. Amen. Praise God.